Some while ago, in a video in which I think I might at some point have been wearing this helmet, but I'm not entirely sure, I told you about Operation Crossfire, which was something I was planning to do, and well, now I have done it. I had volunteers from all around the world who helped out, and it was, I would say, mostly successful. It didn't quite fulfill all my ambitions as a game designer, but then I did aim fairly high, so perhaps I shouldn't be too disappointed.
Right, first piece of advice is don't do it. I've had very little sleep for this last week, and quite a bit of stress. Last night, someone dropped out at 10 o'clock last night, the night before the actual game, someone dropped out, and then someone else said, I've decided to play my game at 4 o'clock in the afternoon my time in the USA. Is that a problem? And I had to explain to him that actually it was a bit of a problem, given that the entire concept of this project is that everyone plays the game at the same time. Last I heard, he was going to try to get up at 7 in the morning to play his game, which is great, only I haven't heard from him since. So maybe that'll happen. It'll be fine.
Now, if you're wondering what this game's all about and so forth, you can watch this video here, and that'll tell you roughly what it was all about. Don't want to go all over that again, and I'm not going to go into a huge amount of detail in this video either, because it would take hours and hours and hours.
I've got 3/4 of an hour now before the game starts, and yes, I am quite stressed. It's become plain to me that this is enormously more than one person should be doing. Anyway, I've got my computer here, and lots of scribbled notes. And I've got the battlefield laid out on my bed. So I've got the various battlefields, and I'm putting these little 6mm figures on, trying to keep track of what's going on. But I'm going to have to rely quite a bit on my players, I think, to be honest. Fortunately, they don't know that I can't really keep track of what they're up to, so perhaps that'll keep them honest.
I've learned something. It turns out that running a core-level military engagement on your own is actually quite a lot of work. Now, in a real war, of course, the commanding generals, they had staff officers and big HQs full of people bustling about, and women in tight-fitting uniforms with those croupier sticks, you know, on the big tables and what have you. I don't know if they were entirely necessary, but they're certainly good to look at. They had all those people to help them. I understand that you really do need lots of people monitoring signals and so forth. In the 4 hours of the actual gameplay, I was sent 839 emails. That's quite a lot. Now, each person sending emails, they only actually wrote an average of 18.6 emails. 18.6 emails, that's not many. It's only one every 13 minutes. The trouble is that there were 45 people. So I was getting an email every 17 seconds.
This is a useful bit of kit. It's a cooker timer that can do 4 different things at the same time. So I can set 4 different times and have this counting down and then going beep. So this can time 4 things that will take some while. So if someone needs to get from this place to that place and I've decided it's going to take him 20 minutes, I can put in number 1 here, 20 minutes, start that counting down and take notes. Oh, boy.
I definitely have learned a powerful experience of why radio discipline is very, very important. When someone emails me and says, my clock's run out of time, Steve, I'm looking at thinking, okay, who is he? Where is he? Which side is he on? Has he achieved his objective? Which objective is he talking about? Did he achieve it under time? Did he go over time? His clock's run out. That's all I know. And that he's called Steve. Half my players were called Steve.
Just got a message. It says, on my way back from the hospital, 25 minutes barring bears and deer. This is a guy in America whose wife has just given birth. And he's rushing back from the birth to play this game. He's had kids before, though. I imagine after a while you get a bit blasé about it.
There were surprise parachute landings and changes in weather and boats turning up and things being spotted from aircraft. I put in a lot of nasty traps for the commanders. For instance, one of them who knew that he had an assault going in by boat that had been organised at the last moment by a rather maverick commando commander, he gets an RAF transcript saying, I've seen some boats, they're not flying an air recognition signal. Shall I engage? And an RAF officer, ground officer, saying, well, they're not on any of my charts. Looks like they've got no reason to be there. Engage. Right, we'll go. And the commander, I sent that to, the commander was very quick to spot what that meant. And he emailed, no, do not engage, do not engage. And then later some other boats were sighted. And he said, yep, engage those on my responsibility. And he was right to, because they were a load of German fast attack boats and they got shot up by the RAF. There were several bridges that the Allies were trying to get and they didn't. And as far as I can tell, the people playing the games found it more than the usual war game. They were aware that they were part of something bigger. Reinforcements kept turning up on their table, or they were ordered to send reinforcements somewhere else, or things moved across their table on their way somewhere else. They were all, of course, screaming for air support and tank support, and strangely, almost nobody asked for reinforcements of infantry, but there you go.
I'm just about to send a message which simply says, cry havoc and let slip the dogs of war. This will be the, there we go. And yes, I am quite nervous.
Some people say that I should try to run one of these commercially.
I'm 3 hours into the game now and I'm completely overwhelmed. Just look at all these emails that I haven't been able to catch up with, oh dear.
Anyway, Operation Crossfire. It's happened and it wasn't so bad. Bye. Indie Man!